This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Socialist Party of America was a multi-tendency democratic socialist and social democratic political party in the United States, formed in 1901 by a merger between the three-year-old Social Democratic Party of America and disaffected elements of the Socialist Labor Party, which had split from the main organization in 1899. In the first decades of the 20th century, it drew significant support from many different groups, including trade unionists, progressive social reformers, populist farmers, and immigrants. However, it refused to form coalitions with other parties, or even to allow its members to vote for other parties. Eugene V. Debs twice won over 900,000 votes in presidential elections 1912 and 1920, while the party also elected two United States representatives, Victor L. Berger and Meyer London, dozens of state legislators, more than 100 mayors, and countless lesser officials. The party's staunch opposition to American involvement in World War I, although welcomed by many, also led to prominent defections, official repression and vigilante persecution. The organization was further shattered by a factional war over how to respond to the October Revolution in Russia in 1917 and the establishment of the Communist International in 1919. Many members left the party in favor of the Communist Party after endorsing Robert La Follette's presidential campaign in 1924. The party returned to independent action at the presidential level. It had modest growth in the early 1930s behind presidential candidate Norman Thomas. The party's appeal was weakened by the popularity of President Franklin D. Roosevelt's New Deal, the organization and flexibility of the Communist Party under Earl Browder, and the resurgent labor movement's desire to support sympathetic Democratic Party politicians. A divisive and ultimately unsuccessful attempt to broaden the party by admitting followers of Leon Trotsky and Jay Lovestone caused the traditional Old Guard to leave and form the Social Democratic Federation. While the party was always strongly anti-fascist, as well as anti-Stalinist, its opposition to American entry in World War II cost it both internal and external support. The party stopped running presidential candidates after 1956, when its nominee Darlington Hoopes won fewer than 6,000 votes in the party's last decades. Its members, many of them prominent in the labor, peace, civil rights, and civil liberties movements, fundamentally disagreed about the socialist movement's relationship to the labor movement and the Democratic Party, and about how best to advance democracy abroad in 1970-1973. These strategic differences had become so acute that the Socialist Party changed its name to Social Democrats. USA leaders of two of its caucuses formed separate socialist organizations, the Democratic Socialist Organizing Committee and the Socialist Party USA. Contents 1 History 11 Early History 12 The split of the left wing 1919-1921-13 Expulsion of socialists from the New York Assembly 1920-14 The quest for a mass farmer labor party 1922-1925-15 The left turn and split of the Old Guard 1928-1936-16 Epoch in California, 1934-17 The demise of the All-Inclusive Party 1937-1940-18 Split with the Trotskyists 19 Collapse of the United Front 1101-1940-1955-111 Reunification 1956-112 Max Schachtman, Civil Rights, and the War on Poverty 113 From the Socialist Party to Social Democrats, USA 114 DSOC and UDS 2 Conventions 3 Socialist Party Presidential Tickets 4 other prominent members 5 important SPA newspapers and magazines 51 official national press 6 executive secretaries 7 See also 8 footnotes 9 bibliography 91 books 911 general histories 912 topical, regional, and local studies 913 biographies of leading participants 92 articles 93 primary sources 10 external links History Early History Main articles, Social Democratic Party of America, Social Democracy of America, and Socialist Labor Party of America. Election poster for Eugene V. Debs, Socialist Party of America candidate for president, 1904. The few own the many because they possess the means of livelihood of all the country is governed for the richest, for the corporations, the bankers, the land speculators, and for the exploiters of labor. The majority of mankind are working people so long as their fair demands, the ownership and control of their livelihoods, are set at naught. We can have neither men's rights nor women's rights. The majority of mankind is ground down by industrial oppression in order order that the small remnant may live in ease. Helen Keller, SPA member, 1913 from 1901 to the onset of World War I. The Socialist Party had numerous elected officials throughout the United States. There were two Socialist members of Congress, Meyer London of New York City and Victor Berger of Milwaukee, a part of the sewer socialism movement, a major front in socialism, Milwaukee being the first city and the only major one to elect a socialist mayor, which it did four times between 1910 and 1956, over 70 mayors, and many state legislators and city councillors. Its voting strength was greatest among recent Jewish, Finnish and German immigrants, coal miners, and former populist farmers in the Midwest from 1900 before its formal union to 1912. The Socialist Party ran Eugene Debs for president at each election. The best showing ever for a socialist ticket was in 1912, when Debs gained 901,551 total votes, or 6% of the popular vote. In 1920, Debs ran again, this time while imprisoned for opposing World War I, and received 913,693 votes, 34% of the total. Early political perspectives ranged from radical socialism to social democracy, with New York Party leader Morris Hillquit and Congressman Berger on the more social democratic or right wing of the party, and radical socialists and syndicalists, including members of the Industrial Workers of the World IWW and the party's frequent candidate, Eugene V. Debs, on the left wing of the party as well. There were agrarian utopian-leaning radicals, such as Julius Wayland of Kansas, who edited the party's leading national newspaper, Appeal to Reason, along with trade unionists, Jewish, Finnish, and German immigrants, and intellectuals such as Walter Lippmann and the black activist, intellectual Hubert Harrison. The party outsourced its newspapers and publications so that it would not have an internal editorial board that was a power in its own right. The result was that a handful of outside publishers dominated the published messages the party distributed, and agitated for a much more radical anti-capitalistic revolutionary message. The party itself tolerated the Appeal to Reason newspaper, thus became part of its radical left wing, as did the Charles H. Kerr Publishing Company of Chicago, which produced over half of the pamphlets and books that were sold at party meetings. The party had a tense and complicated relationship with the American Federation of Labor. The American Federation of Labor leadership, headed by Samuel Gompers, was strongly opposed to the SPA, but many rank-and-file unionists in the early party of the 20th century saw in the socialists reliable political allies. Many moderate socialists, such as Victor Berger and International Typographical Union President Max S. Hayes, urged close cooperation with the American Federation of Labor and its member unions. Others in the Socialist Party's ranks dismissed the American Federation of Labor and its craft unions as antiquated and irrelevant, instead favoring the much more radical IWW and the syndicalist path to socialism. In 1911, IWW leader William Big Bill Haywood was elected to the National Executive Committee of the Socialist Party, on which American Federation of Labor partisan Morris Hillquit also served. The syndicalist and the electoral socialist squared off in a lively public debate in New York City's Cooper Union on January 11, 1912, with Haywood declaring that Hillquit and the socialists ought to try a little sabotage in the right place at the proper time, and attacked Hillquit for having abandoned the class struggle by helping the New York garment workers negotiate an industrial agreement with their employers. Hillquit replied that he had no new message rather than to reiterate a belief in a two-sided workers' movement, with separate and equal political and trade union arms. A mere change of structural forms would not revolutionize the American labor movement as claimed by our extreme industrialists. He declared the issue of syndicalism versus socialism was bitterly fought over the next 2 years, consummated by Big Bill Haywood's recall from the SPA's NEC and the departure of abroad section of the left wing from the organization. The memory of this split made the intra-party battles of 1919-1921 all the more bitter. Eugene V. Debs, founding member and icon of the SPA. The party's opposition to World War I caused a sharp decline in membership and increase in the membership of its language federations from areas involved in the Bolshevik Revolution proved illusory, since these members were soon lost to the Communist Party. The party also lost some of its most prominent members, who had been in favor of America's entry into World War I, including Walter Lippmann, John Spargo, J. G. Phelps Stokes, and William English Walling. They briefly formed the National Party, in an unrealized hope of merging with the remnants of Theodore Roosevelt's Progressive Party and the Prohibition Party. In June 1918, the party's best-known leader, Eugene V. Debs, made an anti-war speech calling for draft resistance. He was arrested under the Sedition Act of 1918, convicted and sentenced to serve 10 years in prison. He was pardoned by President Warren G. Harding in 1921 after a multi-year lobbying effort by the party and other labor activists. By 1918, the Socialist Party of America had won 1,200 political offices, including electing one congressman, 32 state representatives, and 79 mayors. The split of the left wing 1919-1921. This section does not cite any sources. Please help improve this section by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. July 2011. Learn how and when to remove this template message. In January 1919, Vladimir Lenin invited the industrial workers of the world and the radical wing of the Socialist Party to join in the founding of the Communist Third International, the Comintern. The left-wing section of the Socialist Party emerged as an organized faction early that same year, building its organization around a lengthy left-wing manifesto authored by Louis C. Freyna. This effort to organize in order to win the Socialist Party for the left wing met with staunch resistance from the regulars, who controlled a big majority of the seats of the SPA's governing National Executive Committee. When it seemed certain that the 1919 party elections for a new NEC had been dominated by the left wing, the sitting NEC, citing voting irregularities, refused to tally the votes, declared the entire election invalid, and in May 1919 suspended the party's Russian, Latvian, Ukrainian, Polish, South Slavic, and Hungarian language federations, in addition to the entire state organization of Michigan. In future weeks, the state organizations of Massachusetts and Ohio would similarly be disfranchised and reorganized by the NEC, while in New York and Pennsylvania, the regular state executive committees undertook reorganization of left-wing branches and locals on a case-by-case basis. Executive Secretary Adolf Germer was one of five top SPA leaders prosecuted by the Department of Justice in 1919. In June 1919, the left-wing section held a conference in New York City to discuss their organizational plans. The group found themselves deeply divided, with one section, led by NEC members Alfred Wagenknecht and L. E. Katterfeld and including famed radical journalist John Reed, favoring a continued effort to gain control of the SPA at its forthcoming Emergency National Convention in Chicago, to be held at the end of August, while another section, headed by the Russian Socialist Federation of Alexander Stiklitsky and Nicholas Horich and the Socialist Party of Michigan, seeking to wash their hands of the Socialist Party and immediately move to the establishment of a new Communist Party of America. Eventually, this latter federation-dominated group was joined by important left-wingers C. E. Ruthenberg and Louis Freyna, a depletion of left-wing forces which made the result of the 1919 Socialist Convention a foregone conclusion. Alfred Wagenknecht, top leader of the 1919 SPA left wing. Regardless, the plans of Wagenknecht, Reed, to the gathering were controlled by the executive secretary Adolf Germer and the regulars, a group of left-wingers without delegate credentials, including John Reed and his sidekick Benjamin Gitlow, made an effort to occupy chairs on the convention floor before the gathering was called into order. The incumbents were unable to block the left-wingers at the door, but soon called the already present police to their aid, and the officers of the law obligingly expelled the boisterous radicals from the hall. With the credentials committee firmly in the hands of the regulars from the outset, the outcome of the gathering was no longer in doubt, and most of the remaining left-wing delegates departed, to meet with other co-thinkers downstairs in a previously reserved room in a parallel convention. It was this gathering which established itself as the Communist Labor Party on August 31, 1919. Meanwhile, elsewhere in Chicago, the Federations and Michiganders and their supporters established the Communist Party of America at a convention gaveled to order on September 1, 1919. Unity between these two communist organizations was a lengthy and complicated process, formally taking place at a secret convention held at the Overlook Mountain House Hotel near Woodstock, New York, in May 1921, with the establishment of a new unified Communist Party of America. A left wing loyal to the Communist International remained in the Socialist Party through 1921, continuing the fight to bring the SPA into the ranks of the Comintern. This group, which opposed the underground secret organizations which the communist parties had become, included noted party journalist J. Louis Engdahl and William Cruz, head of the party's youth affiliate, the Young People's Socialist League, as well as a significant segment of the SPA's Chicago organization. These left-wing dissidents continued to make themselves heard until their departure from the party after the convention of 1921. Expulsion of socialists from the New York Assembly. 1920. On January 7, 1920, less than a week after the Palmer raids had swept and stunned the country, a new session of the New York State Assembly was called to order. The majority Republicans easily elected their candidate for the Speaker, Thaddeus C. Sweet, and after opening day formalities the body took a brief recess back in session. Sweet declared, "The chair directs the sergeant-at-arms to present before the bar of the House Samuel A. DeWitt, Samuel Orr, Louis Waldman, Charles Solomon, and August Classens, the Assembly's five socialist members." The five socialist assemblymen suspended by the New York State Legislature in January 1920. Sweet attacked the five, declaring they had been elected on a platform that is absolutely inimical to the best interests of the state of New York and the United States. The Socialist Party, Sweet said, was not truly a political party, but was rather a membership organization admitting within its ranks aliens, enemy aliens, and minors. The party had denounced America's participation in the European War and had lent aid and comfort to Ludwig Martens, the self-styled Soviet ambassador and alien, who entered this country as a German in 1916. It had supported the revolutionaries in Germany, Austria, and Hungary, Sweet continued, and consorted with international socialist parties close to the Communist International. Sweet concluded, "It is every citizen's right to his day in court if this House should adopt a resolution declaring your seat herein vacant. Pending a hearing before a tribunal of this House, you will be given an opportunity to appear before such tribunal to prove your right to a seat in this legislative body, and upon the result of such hearing and the findings of the Assembly Tribunal, your right to participate in the actions of this body will be determined." The Assembly suspended the quintet by a vote of 140-6, with one Democrat supporting the socialists. Civil libertarians and concerned citizens raised their voices to aid the suspended socialists, and protest percolated throughout the press. The principal argument was that majority parties expelling elected members of minority parties from their councils set a dangerous precedent in a democracy. The battle culminated in a highly publicized trial in the Assembly, which dominated the body's activity from its opening on January 20, 1920, until its conclusion on March 11. Socialist Party leader and former 1917 New York City mayoral candidate Morris Hillquit served as chief counsel for the suspended socialists, aided by party founder, and future socialist vice presidential candidate, Seymour Stedman. At the trial, Hillquit charged that Speaker Sweet had made a specific, concrete, definite, affirmative declaration of guilt of the five assemblymen before they were ever charged with any offense. It was the chief accuser, Speaker Sweet, who also appointed the members of the Judiciary Committee to which the matter was referred. Thus the accuser selects his own judges. Hillquit declared Hillquit sought to remove for reasons of bias any members of the Judiciary Committee who had taken part in the activities of the Lusk Committee, the New York State Senate's Anti-Radicalism Committee. Hillquit particularly challenged the presence of Assemblyman Louis A. Cuvillier, who had stated on the floor of the House the previous night words to the effect that if the five accused assemblymen are found guilty, they ought not to be expelled, but taken out and shot. The Assembly voted overwhelmingly for expulsion on April 1, 1920. A special election was held September 16, 1920, to fill the five seats vacated by the Assembly, with each of the five expelled socialists running for re-election against a fusion candidate representing the combined Republican and Democratic parties. All five socialists were returned to office. Three of the five, Waldman, Classens, and Solomon, were again denied their seats after a contentious debate by votes of 90-45 on September 21, 1920. Orr and DeWitt, deemed less culpable than their peers by the earlier findings of the Judiciary Committee, were seated by votes of 87-48 in solidarity with their ousted colleagues. The pair refused to take their seats after the five seats were again vacated. Morris Hillquit expressed his disappointment at the unconstitutional action of the Assembly. However, Hillquit continued, "It will draw the issues clearer between the United Republican and Democratic parties representing arbitrary lawlessness, and the Socialist Party, which stood and stands for democratic and representative government." The legislature attempted to prevent the election and seating of socialists in the future by passing laws designed to exclude the Socialist Party from recognition as a political party and to alter the legislature's oath-taking procedures so that elected members could be excluded before being sworn. Governor Al Smith vetoed the legislation. The quest for a mass farmer labor party 1922-1925. Morris Hillquit, chairman of the SPA from the death of Debs until he himself died in 1933 in the first half of 1919, 1919, the Socialist Party had over 100,000 dues-paying members. By the second half of 1921, it had been shattered. Fewer than 14,000 members remained in party ranks, with the departure of the large and well-funded Finnish Socialist Federation adding to the malaise in September 1921. The NEC of the party determined that the time had come to end. The party's historic aversion to fusion with other political organizations and issue an appeal declaring that the forces of every progressive, liberal, and radical organization of the workers must be mobilized to repel conservative assaults and advance the industrial and political power of the working class. This desire for common action seems to have been shared by various unions. As late in 1921, a call was issued in the name of the country's 16 major railway labor unions seeking a Conference for Progressive Political Action (CPPA). The CPPA was originally intended to be an umbrella organization bringing together various elements of the farmer and labor movement together in a common program. Invitations to the group's founding conference were issued to members of a wide variety of progressive organizations of widely varied perspectives. As a result, from its inception, the heterogeneous body was unable to agree on even a program or even a declaration of principles, let alone congeal into a new political party. The Socialist Party was an enthusiastic supporter of the CPPA, and the group dominated its thinking from the start of 1922 through the first quarter of 1925. The party sought, in this period of organizational weakness, to forge lasting ties with the existing trade union movement, leading in short order to a mass labor party in the United States. On the British model, a first national conference of the CPPA was held in Chicago in February 1922, attended by 124 delegates representing a broad spectrum of labor, farmer, and political organizations. The gathering passed an address to the American people, stating its criticism of existing conditions and formally proposing an amorphous plan of action validating the status quo ante. The labor unions on the group's right wing to endorse labor-friendly candidates of the Democratic Party, the Socialists and Farmer Labor Party adherents on the group's left wing to conduct their own independent campaigns. Perhaps the most important thing the CPPA did at its first national conference, from the Socialist Party's perspective, was agree to meet again. The SP leadership understood the process of building an independent third party which could count on the allegiance of the country's trade union leadership would be a protracted process, and the mere fact of agreement to disagree but nevertheless meeting again was regarded as a step forward. The communist movement also sought to pursue the strategy of bursting from its isolation through the formation of a mass farmer labor party. Finally emerged from its underground existence in 1922, the communists, through their legal political party, the Workers' Party of America, decided to send four delegates to the December 1922 gathering of the CPPA. However, the Credentials Committee, after protracted debate, strongly objected to the participation of communist representatives in its proceedings and issued a recommendation that the representatives of the Workers' Party and its youth organization not be seated. The Socialist Party's delegates were strongly in favor of the exclusion of the communists and acted accordingly. Even though the two organizations shared a vision of a party akin to the British Labour Party in which constituent political groups jointly participated while retaining their independent existence, the fissure between the organizations was thus widened. As with the first conference, the second conference of the CPPA split over the all-important issue of an independent political party, with a proposal by five delegates of the Farmer Labour Party calling for independent political action by the agricultural and industrial workers through a party of their own, defeated by a vote of 52-64. A majority report declaring against an independent political party was instead adopted. This defeat of the bid for an independent political party cost the CPPA one its major component organizations, with the Farmer Labor Party delegation announcing that their group would no longer affiliate with the CPPA after the close of the convention. Although the Socialists did not realize it at the time, the chances that the organization would ever be transformed into an authentic mass farmer labor party of the British Labour type were greatly lessened with the departure of the FLP. Still, the Socialists remained optimistic. The May 1923 National Convention of the SP voted, after lengthy debate, to retain its affiliation with the CPPA and to continue its work for an independent political party from within that group. The May 20th vote in favour of maintaining affiliation with the CPPA was 38-12, failing a mass farmer labour party from the CPPA. The Socialists sought at least a powerful presidential nominee to run in opposition to the old Party's a third national conference of the CPPA was held in St. Louis, Missouri on February 11 and 12, 1924, a gathering which punted on the issue of committing itself to the 1924 presidential campaign, deciding instead to immediately issue a call for a convention of workers, farmers, and progressives for the purpose of taking action on nomination of candidates for the offices of President and Vice President of the United States, and on other questions that may come before the convention. The decisive moment finally came on 4 July, 1924, a date which was not accidentally selected. The first national convention of the CPPA was assembled in Cleveland at the City Auditorium, which was packed with close to 600 delegates representing international unions, state federations of labor, branches of cooperative societies, state branches and national officers of the socialist, farmer labor, and progressive parties, as well as the Committee of 48, state and national affiliates of the Women's Committee on Political Action, and sundry individuals. Very few farmers were in attendance. SPA ally Robert M. Lafollette Sr. left attempted to build a broad labor alliance during the 1924 campaign. He meets here with Samuel Gompers of the American Federation of Labor. The National Committee had previously requested that Wisconsin Senator Robert M. Lafollette Sr. make a run for the presidency. The Cleveland Convention was addressed by the senator's son, Robert M. Lafollette Jr., who read a message from his father accepting the call and declaring that the time had come for a militant political movement independent of the two old party organizations. Lafollette declined to lead a third party, however, seeking to protect those progressives elected nominally as Republicans and Democrats. Lafollette declared that the primary issue of the 1924 campaign was the breaking of the combined power of the private monopoly system over the political and economic life of the American people. After the November election, a new party might well be established, Lafollette stated, that might unite all progressives. The Socialist Party enthusiastically supported the independent candidacy of Lafollette, declining to run their own candidate in November 1924. Although the Lafollette candidacy garnered 5 million votes, it failed to seriously challenge the hegemony of the old parties and was regarded by the unions as a disappointing failure. Following the election, the governing National Committee of the CPPA met in Washington, D.C. while the body had a mandate from the July convention to issue a call for a convention to organize a new political party. The representatives of the critical railway unions, with the exception of William H. Johnston of the Machinists, were united in opposition to idea. The railroad unions instead proposed a motion not to hold the 1925 organizational convention. This proposal was defeated by a vote of 30-13. Following their defeat on this question, the railroaders on National Committee members withdrew from the meeting, announcing that they would await further instructions from their respective organizations with regards to future participation. The loss of the very unions who had brought about the CPPA spelled its demise. A convention to decide on the formation of a new political party was nonetheless scheduled by the National Committee for February 21, 1925, to be held in Chicago. Labor, the official organ of the railway unions, did nothing to promote this second convention of the CPPA, stating that since the executives of the various unions had taken no stance on the matter, it would be up to subordinate sections to consider sending delegates themselves. The February 1925 convention found its task was virtually insurmountable. However, as the heterogeneous organization had split over the fundamental question of realignment of the major parties via the primary elections process as opposed to establishment of a new competitive political party, the railway unions, whose efforts who had originally brought the CPPA into existence, were fairly solidly united against the third-party tactic, instead favoring continuation of the CPPA as a sort of pressure group for progressive change within the structure of the Democratic and Republican parties. L.E. Shepard, president of the Order of Railway Conductors of America, presented a resolution calling for a continuation of the CPPA on nonpartisan lines as a political pressure group. This proposal was met by an amendment by Morris Hillquit of the Socialist Party, who called the 5 million votes cast for Lafollette an encouraging beginning and urged action for establishment of an American Labour Party on the British model, in which constituent groups retained their organizational autonomy within the larger umbrella organization. A third proposal was made by Ja Hopkins of the Committee of 48, which called for establishment of a progressive party built around individual enrollments. No vote was ever taken by the convention on any of the three proposals, mooted instead. After some debate, the convention was unanimously adjourned. 1989 die, bringing an abrupt end to the Conference for Progressive Political Action. Eugene V. Debs addressed a mass meeting including delegates of the convention in a keynote address delivered at the Lexington Hotel early in the afternoon of February 21 after the Debs speech. Those delegates favoring establishment of a new political party were then reconvened, with the opponents of an independent political party departing. The reconvened founding convention found itself split between adherents of a non-class progressive party based upon individual memberships as opposed to the socialists' conception of a class-conscious labor party employing direct affiliation of organizations of workers and farmers and of progressive political and educational groups who fully accept its program and principles. Following extensive debate, the socialist counter-proposal was defeated by a vote of 93-64. The trade unions it coveted gone, the farmers non-existent, the Socialist Party exited the convention and abandoned the strategy of establishing a new mass party through the CPPAA. Progressive Party was formed by the remaining liberals, and the group survived for a short time in a limited number of states throughout the 1920s. The left turn and split of the Old Guard 1928-1936. Clarence Sr., SPA executive secretary from August 1929 to late 1936. In 1928, the Socialist Party returned as an independent electoral entity under the leadership of Norman Thomas, a radical Protestant minister from New York City. This re-entry into the electoral fray behind the dynamic Thomas fueled major growth of the SP during the first years of Great Depression, primarily among youth. A skilled orator and advocate of the step-by-step solution of social problems, Thomas had excellent access to churches, colleges, and civic institutions. Thomas also had, as New York Social Democrat Lewis Waldman later noted, those qualities of mind and character which appealed to the intelligent and educated young people of the country and which drew them into the ranks of the party in unprecedented numbers. The 1928 convention voted to reduce membership dues to just $1 per year, with only half of that sum going to the use of the national office, the balance being retained by state and local organizations. This level of funding proved insufficient for anything beyond the bare minimum of operations by the national office in Chicago. No official party publication was made available to the members of the organization, with several privately held socialist newspapers fulfilling the function as fonts of party information. The dues rate cut did prove helpful in helping to reduce the party's membership slide after nearly a decade of steady decline. The Socialist Party again began to grow, advancing from a low of under 8,000 dues payers in 1928 to a membership of almost 17,000 by 1932. This growth came at a price, however, as deep factional divisions developed between the youthful newcomers radicalized and drawn to militant Marxism by the world economic crisis and the Old Guard, headed by Morris Hillquit, James O'Neill, and Waldman. The generational battle first erupted at the May 1932 Milwaukee Convention. Participant Anna Berkowitz noted four primary factions at this gathering: an Old Guard defending the current course of the party and the position of national chairman Morris Hillquit, practical socialists of the Milwaukee type, the young Marxist militants, and liberal pacifist Thomasites such as Devere Allen, who followed the lead of the charismatic Thomas. The groups which represented the so-called New Blood at the convention, the militants and the liberals, and which at this convention merged for the sole purpose of deposing the present leadership, had little in common. Many members of the most aggressive, although numerically weakest of these groups, the militants, had little in common with the so-called Thomasites, and as for the so-called Midwestern group, although they cast their vote with the opposition, on fundamentals they too are opposed to much of the liberalizing tendencies manifest in the party in recent years, yet they voted, contrary to their usual procedure in their respective communities, with the opposition. That trades had been made there can be no doubt, and that some groups had been used as innocent dupes can also hardly be doubted. Fundamentally, there is much more in common between the militants and the so-called Old Guard than between the militants and the Thomasites, and surely than between the frank, practical Midwestern type of socialists. Yet when it was a question of vote on the Russian resolution, on the two resolution, and on the question of the national chairman and the executive committee, votes were not cast on the basis of principles but apparently on the basis of trades. The real difference between the militants and the Old Guard seems to be based on lack of sufficient activity and on tempo rather than on principle. Hillquit was challenged at the 1932 convention by Daniel Hone of Milwaukee, with the militants and the Thomas group voting for Hone with the Midwesterners. Hillquit was re-elected national chairman by a vote of 105-86, representing paid memberships of 7,526 1926 to 6,984 six members of the newly elected NEC were adherents of the Hillquit Old Guard faction. It is clear that to some large extent the controversy between the young newcomers of the militant faction and that of the so-called Old Guard can be reduced to this struggle for practical control of the party apparatus. Historian Frank Warren notes that one cannot understand the Old Guard's actions unless one recognizes its intense desire to maintain its place in the party hierarchy. The drives of the young were a threat to the power of the New York Old Guard. He also adds that clearly one would falsely idealize the militants if one failed to recognize that their ambitions were not always selfless. But in addition to the raw struggle for control of the party apparatus, there was also a divergence of visions about the role of the SP in the then-current crisis of capitalism. With mass unemployment at home and the growth of fascism and militarism abroad, the alternative vision of the militants would be expressed at the subsequent convention of the party, held in Detroit in June 1934, at which it was Norman Thomas and his tactical allies of the militant faction which would emerge triumphant. It was this gathering which adopted a new declaration of principles which inflamed the Old Guard faction on a number of different levels. Lewis Waldman, a top leader of the Old Guard. The ideological differences between the radical pacifist Thomas and his allies of the militant faction, on the one hand, and the Old Guard faction, on the other, have been succinctly summarized as follows. The Old Guard was convinced that the 1934 Declaration of Principles was an open declaration in favor of armed insurrection. Thomas believed it was a necessary statement to indicate that socialists would not lie down in the face of fascism. The Old Guard believed that the anti-war sections of the Declaration of Principles placed the party under the threat of legal prosecution for advocating unlawful actions to oppose war. Again, Thomas believed that a strong statement was necessary to put capitalism on warning that if it engaged in imperialist war there would be opposition. The Old Guard believed that a united front with the communists was immoral and would be disastrous for the socialists, that even limited united action on specific causes should be banned, and even that exploratory discussions about a united front were going too far. Thomas opposed a united front on a general level, including any joint actions in political contests, but he thought that carefully planned united action on specific cases could, and should, take place, and he believed that it was worthwhile to conduct exploratory talks, even though he felt they would likely lead to nothing. The Old Guard felt that the socialists' invitation to unaffiliated radicals and the party's acceptance of former communists, Lovestoneites, and Trotskyists was turning the party away from democratic socialism and to communism. Thomas, though he disagreed with the ideology of these anti-Stalinist communists, was willing to try to work with a party that included them, if they were willing to accept party discipline and not try to take over the party. The Old Guard considered the Revolutionary Policy Committee, a far-left group within the Socialist Party, a communist and anarchist group that had no place in a democratic socialist party. Thomas disagreed with the Romantic Revolutionists in the Revolutionary Policy Committee as he disagreed with the Romantic parliamentarians of the Old Guard, but still felt it was useful to try to salvage some of the enthusiasm and dedication that went into the Revolutionary Policy Committee by permitting its members to remain in the party if, again, they followed party policy and party discipline. In addition to the generational and ideological differences between the young militant faction and the Old Guard, and their divergence over tempo of activity and party personnel, was great disagreement about matters of symbolism and style. Many of the young radicals dressed and acted in marked contrast to their staid, buttoned-down elders, as New York Old Guard leader Lewis Waldman recounted in a 1944 memoir. Symptoms of a new and dangerous spirit among the socialist youth began to become manifest on all sides. The youngsters appeared at meetings of the party in blue shirts and red ties. At first this attracted no special attention, for oddity in dress is no novelty among radicals, but gradually their number increased and we now could see that this was a uniform. The socialist youth of America, like the fascist youth in Europe, had succumbed to the shirt mania. The shirt tendency was followed by the salute mania in Europe. The Nazi salute was the outstretched arm. Here in America the united front was symbolized by the adoption of the communist clenched fist salute. This greeting, a raised arm at a slightly different angle from the Nazi or communist salute, now became routine at all our meetings. Some of the older members of the party were truly horrified at this totalitarian tendency, but others couldn't resist the trend and fell into line. Among these, I painfully record, was Norman Thomas. Along with the blue shirts, the red ties, the clenched fists, the raised arm salute, came the banners, the slogans, the demonstrations, all the trappings that make for totalitarian, unthinking mass fervor. These now became regular features at party gatherings. I can still recall the howl of triumph that rose from these young people at one of our meetings when, for the first time, Norman Thomas returned the clenched fist salute to them as I stood at his side, my arms deliberately folded to indicate that I would have no part of this. Their cheers for Thomas rose to almost uncontrollable frenzy. Following its loss on the floor of the Detroit Convention, the old guard then took its case to the rank and file of the party, which had been called upon to either approve or defeat the new Declaration of Principles in referendum vote. A Committee for the Preservation of the Socialist Party was established, and an agitational pamphlet published. New York State Assemblyman Charles Solomon was the author of the group's first polemical piece urging defeat of the 1934 Declaration of Principles by the membership at referendum, entitled Detroit and the Party. In this pamphlet, Solomon decried the Detroit Declaration of Principles as reckless, observing pointedly that furious phrases cannot take the place of organized mass power. Solomon noted that over the past 3 or 4 years there had arisen certain definite groups in the ranks of the Socialist Party. He continued, Chaim Kantorovich, chief theoretician of the militant faction, the declaration does not stand by itself, in a vacuum, as it were. Important as it is, it does not alone account for the vital struggle that is now being waged in the party. It represents the culminating point of a deep-seated antagonism. It is like the straw that breaks or threatens to break the camel's back. The Declaration of Principles has brought to the surface divergences which are deep, antagonisms which make of our party not a coherent political organization working harmoniously for a common objective but a battleground of internecine strife. Solomon charged that the so-called left was making its position clear with the Declaration of Principles. There was no mistaking the flag it had unfurled. He declared, it was the banner of thinly veiled communism, while he declared that the Declaration of Principles must be decisively rejected in the referendum. He nevertheless strongly hinted that a factional split was in the offing. Merely defeating the proposed Declaration of Principles was not enough. He concluded, the Socialist Party must be made safe for socialism, for social democracy. American Socialist Quarterly editor Chaim Kantorovich made the case for the militant faction in a pamphlet urging approval of the Declaration of Principles at referendum. He observed that the Declaration of Principles does not call for insurrection or violence. It simply states that if capitalism should collapse, the Socialist Party will not shrink from the responsibility of taking power in case of a collapse of capitalism. If the socialists refuse to take power, the fascists will to say beforehand that in time of a general collapse of capitalism the socialists will not dare take power before they have a clear mandate from the majority through a democratic vote, is the same as saying that in case of a general collapse of capitalism the socialists Party will voluntarily, in the name of democracy, turn over the power to the fascists or other reactionary elements, and continue their democratic propaganda from concentration camps. The membership of the Socialist Party approved the 1934 Declaration of Principles in its referendum vote, a victory which moved the Old Guard towards the exits. Although factional fighting into 1936, the leaders of the Old Guard formed a new rival organization to the Socialist Party, the Social Democratic Federation, in 1936, and somewhat reluctantly endorsed Franklin Roosevelt for president in the election of that year. They also worked to establish the American Labor Party ALP, a labor-oriented umbrella organization that included both socialist and non-socialist elements, putting forward both its own candidates as well as endorsing those of the Democratic and Republican parties. For more detail on the 1934-36 split, see Social Democratic Federation Epic in California, 1934. Upton Sinclair, a prominent novelist, had long been associated with the Socialist Party in California. He was twice its candidate for Congress, and its nominee for governor in 1930, but won fewer than 50,000 votes in 1934. Sinclair ran in the Democratic primary for governor, and astonished everyone by a sweeping victory in the primary on his promise of radical socialist economic reforms. He dubbed End Poverty and California Movement. Epic conservative and Republican elements rallied against Sinclair and managed to defeat him in the general election. The Socialist Party in California and nationwide refused to allow its members to be active in any other party, including the Democratic Party, and expelled him, along with socialists who supported his California campaign. Sinclair won 800,000 votes on the Democratic ticket, and helped elect several Epic supporters to the legislature. The socialist candidate who ran against him won only 3,000 votes. The expulsions destroyed the Socialist Party in California. The demise of the All-Inclusive Party, 1937-1940. Norman Thomas, six-time presidential candidate of the Socialist Party. Norman Thomas and his radical pacifist co-thinkers and their young Marxist allies of the militant faction sought to build a mass political movement by transforming the Socialist Party into what they called an All-Inclusive Party. Not only would an appeal be made to the radical intellectuals and trade unionists who were the historic core of the organization, but an effort would be made to work closely with the Communist Party in joint actions, and to infuse the Socialist Party with the leading personnel of small radical oppositional organizations, including in particular the anti-Stalinist communist groupings headed by J. Lovestone, the so-called Lovestonites, and James P. Cannon, the so-called Trotskyists. To be sure, an impressive array of left-wing intellectuals came into the socialist orbit as a result of this venture, including from the Lovestonites Bertram D. Wolfe, Herbert Zamm, and Benjamin Gitlow, as well as from the Trotskyists Max Schachtman, James Burnham, Martin Abern, and Hal Draper. A broad array of radicals from other tendencies also contributed to the pages of the party's official theoretical journal, including from the Communist Party orbit Joseph P. Lash of the American Student Union, the radical novelist James T. Farrell, public intellectual Sidney Hook, leading American Marxist of the 1910s Louis B. Boudin, and Canadian Trotskyist Maurice Spector, among others. A very real bid was made to unite the factionalized and marginalized American left in a common cause, and great hope was held for success in the enterprise after the rise of the Nazis in Germany and Austria by 1934. No longer did the Communist Party engage in its third period epithets against the socialists as so-called social fascists. Lillian Symes wrote in the SP's theoretical magazine in February 1937 of the incredible change seen to be taking place in the Communist Party in its seeming abandonment of sectarianism and move towards building a broad people's front against fascism. At the same time, other radical organizations sought to alter their tactics so as to rapidly build an aggressive left-wing organization to stand in opposition to nascent fascism. From early 1934, the French Trotskyist organization had entered the French Socialist Party in an effort to build its strength and win support for its ideas. Pressure to follow this policy of the French turn was building among the American Trotskyist group for a brief historical moment in 1935 and 1936. The vision of the SP as an all-inclusive party which aggregated radical oppositionists and possibly even worked with the Communist Party in common cause seemed achievable in January 1936, just as the National Executive Committee of the Socialist Party was expelling the Old Guard. A factional battle was being won in the Trotskyist Workers' Party of the United States to join the SP, when a national branch referendum voted unanimously for entry. Negotiations commenced between the Workers' Party and socialist leaderships, with the decision ultimately made to allow admissions only on the basis of individual applications for membership rather than on mass admission of the entire group on June 6, 1936. The Workers' Party's weekly newspaper, The New Militant, published its last issue and announced Workers' Party calls all revolutionary workers to join Socialist Party. Approximately half of the Workers' Party heeded the call and entered the SPA. Although party leader Jim Cannon later hinted that the entry of the Trotskyists into the Socialist Party had been a contrived tactic aimed at stealing confused young left socialists for his own organization, it seems that at its inception, the entryist tactic was made in good faith. Historian Constance Myers notes that while initial prognoses for the union of Trotskyists and socialists were favorable, it was only later when constant and protracted contact caused differences to surface. The Trotskyists retained a common orientation with the radicalized SP in their opposition to the European War, their preference for industrial unionism and the CIO over the trade unionism of the American Federation of Labor, a commitment to trade union activism, the defense of the Soviet Union as the first workers' state while at the same time maintaining an antipathy toward the Stalin regime, and in their general aims in the 1936 election. Norman Thomas attracted nearly 188,000 votes in his 1936 Socialist Party run for president but performed poorly in historic strongholds of the party. Moreover, the party's membership had begun to decline. The organization was deeply factionalized, with the militant faction split into right Altmanite, center Clarity, and left Appeal factions, in addition to the radical pacifists led by Norman Thomas and the Midwestern constructive socialists led by Dan Hoehn. A special convention was planned for the last week of March 1937 to set the party's future policy, initially intended as an unprecedented secret gathering. Split with the Trotskyists prior to the March convention, the Trotskyist Socialist Appeal faction held an organizational gathering of their own, meeting in Chicago, with 93 delegates gathering from February 20-22, 1937. The meeting organized the faction on a permanent basis, electing a National Action Committee of five to coordinate branch work and formulate appeal policies. Two delegates from the Clarity Caucus were in attendance. James Burnham vigorously attacked the Labour and Socialist International, the international organization of left-wing parties to which the Socialist Party belonged, and tension rose along these lines among the Trotskyists. United action between the Clarity and Appeal groups was not forthcoming, and an emergency meeting of Vincent Dunn and Cannon was held in New York with leaders of the various factions, including Thomas, Jack Altman, and Gus Tyler of Clarity. At this meeting, Thomas pledged that the upcoming convention would make no effort to terminate the newspapers of the various factions. No action was taken at the 1937 convention to expel the Trotskyist Appeal faction, but pressure did continue to build along these lines, fueled by the CPUSA's increasingly hysterical denunciations of Trotsky and his followers as wreckers and agents of international fascism. The convention did pass a ban on future branch resolutions on controversial matters, an effort to rein in the activities of the factions at the local level. It also did ban factional newspapers, a move directly targeting the Socialist Appeal, and formally established the Socialist Call as the party's national organ. Constance Myers indicates that three factors led to the expulsion of the Trotskyists from the Socialist Party in 1937: the divergence between the official Socialists and the Trotskyist faction on the issues, the determination of Altman's wing of the militants to oust the Trotskyists, and Trotsky's own decision to move towards a break with the party, recognizing that the Clarity faction had chosen to stand with the Altmanites and the Thomas group. Trotsky recommended that the Appeal group focus on disagreements over Spain to provoke a split. At the same time, Thomas, freshly returned from Spain, had come to the conclusion that the Trotskyists had joined the SP not to make it stronger, but to capture the organization for their own purposes. On June 24-25, 1937, a meeting of the Appeal faction's National Action Committee voted to ratchet it up the rhetoric against American Labor Party and Republican nominee for mayor of New York Fiorello LaGuardia, a favorite son of many in socialist ranks, and to re-establish their newspaper, the Socialist Appeal. This was met with expulsions from the party beginning August 9 with a rump meeting of the Central Committee of Local New York, which expelled 52 New York Trotskyists by a vote of 48-2, with 18 abstentions, and ordering 70 more to be brought up on charges. Wholesale expulsions followed, with a major section of the YPSL leaving the party with the Trotskyists. Secretary of Local New York Jack Altman declared that the Trotskyists were expelled for attempting to undermine the Socialist Party, for loyalty and allegiance to an opponent organization, the Bureau of the Fourth International, and for refusing to abide by the decisions and discipline of the National Convention, the National Executive Committee, and the City Central Committee of the party, and for no other reason. Editor Gus Tyler of the Socialist Call echoed Altman's sentiments, emphasizing that the Trotskyites have, during the last week, abandoned the usual means of inter-party controversy, debate and appeals through party channels, and, like the old guard, have carried their argument into the public, into the capitalist press. The issuance of a statement by the Trotskyist faction to the New York Times and the relaunch of their own newspaper, the Socialist Appeal, was seen as particularly galling by the Call's editor. Collapse of the United Front. The youth and militants of the Depression era SP is reflected in the cover of this 1935 song book published by the SP-affiliated Rand School Press. Things turned out no better with the official Communist Party, devoted as it was to the Stalin regime in the USSR. The February to March 1937 joint plenum of the Central Committee and Central Control Commission of the All-Union Communist Party in the Moscow, which green-lighted a massive avalanche of secret police terror known to history as the Great Purge, changed everything. Baby steps towards multi-candidate elections and the rule of law in the USSR crumbled instantly as show trials, spy mania, mass arrests, and mass executions swept the land. The Trotskyist movement in the USSR was particularly targeted, accused of plotting murder of Soviet officials and conducting sabotage and espionage in preparation for a fascist invasion, seemingly insane charges which were honestly believed by the Soviet elite. Blood flowed like water as alleged Trotskyists and other politically suspect individuals were rounded up, investigated, and disposed with a pistol shot in the base of the skull or a 10-year sentence in the gulag. Around the world, the adherents of Stalin and Trotsky raged against one another. In Spain, the country in which the Lovestonites invested most of their emotional energy as fervid supporters of the Workers' Party of Marxist Unification POUM, 1937 marked a similar bloodbath, with the Communist Party of Spain achieving hegemony among the Republican forces and conducting bloody purges of their own at the behest arrest of the Soviet secret police joint action between communist oppositionists and the unflinching loyalists to Moscow was henceforth an abject impossibility. In 1937, Norman Thomas willingly acceded to a request from the League for Industrial Democracy LID to author a pamphlet on the topic of democracy versus dictatorship. Thomas pulled no punches about his views of the regime in the USSR.